Census Fidei from Vatican II to Pope Francis, the Latin word census fidei, the sense of the faithful. And really it's a dogmatic area, it's a theological area, but I've been asked to give a presentation in terms of history and from historical methodology that I specialise in. So to do it justice, my friend and colleague Kevin Linehan could be here doing it, because it's a very specific area of theology, but tonight I want to give it a historical spin and to see this quite dense theological concept and idea actually part of a wider, what I call a historical pantheon of ideas and developments in the church that I believe are affecting the church universally, but in particular for the church in Australia at this time. So bear with me as we go on this little journey. It's always a historical journey for me, from Vatican II to Pope Francis and the whole heart and depth of this idea of census fidei. So, if you look at the handout there, right? So, the first dot point there, in 2014, not long ago, 4 years ago, the International Theological Commission put out a specific document called Census Fidei in the Life of the Church. And again, there's a lot of Vatican documents. It's quite dense, quite long, and quite theological, okay? But there's a little gem that I want to, you know, launch out with tonight from here that gives us the compass and the movement point for my presentation. So census fidei picks up this whole idea of, you know, literally the sense of the faithful and the way the tradition is lived and celebrated and transmitted. And of course, with our historical critical eyes, we can now say, and develops over time and is shaped by the culture and responds to the culture and is in dialogue with the culture thanks to the gift of the Second Vatican Council. Okay, so that's all a bit of a prelude to giving you the quote now. So, follow with me. The faithful have an instinct for the truth of the gospel, which enables them to recognize and endorse authentic Christian doctrine and practice. They recognize and endorse authentic Christian doctrine and practice, and to reject what is false. That supernatural instinct, intrinsically linked to the gift of faith received in the communion of the church, is called the sensus fidei, sense of the faithful, and that enables Christians to fulfill their prophetic calling. To fulfill their prophetic calling. Now, when we hear the word prophetic or prophets, what comes to mind first up? Prophetic or prophets?
Preaching.
What else?
Witness.
Speaking of the future.
Yeah. Where does this tradition come from, this prophetic tradition? The Old Testament, okay? The great prophets of the Old Testament, we put them on hold in the Easter season, 50 days, because every reading for the first reading, 7 days a week, we have the Acts of the Apostles. That's how the liturgy goes. But when we go back to ordinary time, occasionally we get readings from the prophets, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Micah, etc. Okay? So they're from the Old Testament tradition. Where else in a Catholic life and culture and faith, when you hear the word prophetic, it's associated with who else? Louder?
Messenger,
yep. Who else? Who are our great examples of models of faith?
The saints.
The popes, apostles.
Saints,
okay. Here we are on this territory across the road from where our first saint in Australia was born, okay? Right across the road, Mary McGill. First and only saint, a prophetic woman, okay? Right throughout our tradition. Prophetic people, so it's the Old Testament idea of prophets and justice, but in our lived Catholic experience from the early saints and martyrs of the early church and early persecution to contemporary saints, to extraordinary men and women, heroic martyrs, evangelists, missionaries, teachers, mystics, of course, and our own, from this literally raised up from this soil, our own Mary MacKillop, okay, who felt God's call and responded with her gifts and greatly changed the face of Catholicism. So, now the church is saying here, it's not just Old Testament characters, it's not just great men and women from the tradition, the great pantheon of the communion of saints, but this is something given to the faithful. A grace and a charism, that great word given by Vatican II, that the faithful share in, okay? So when you hear that, again, that sense of being in communion with the story of salvation, God's work in the Old Testament, the New Testament with Jesus, and the whole tradition of 2,000 years of the church, okay? Men and women, saints, prophetic people, and as I said, here we are, right across the road from where our own first saint was born. Okay? Dot point two.
The importance of census fide in the life of the church was strongly emphasized by the Second Vatican Council. In particular, the development of this idea of the teaching church, Ecclesia Docens, and the learning church, Ecclesia Discens. Now, before the council, we had a very clear idea of the teaching church was the Pope, the bishops, theologians, and pastors. They taught that they were the teaching church, okay? And the faithful were the learning, listening church, almost in a passive mode, receiving the teaching, okay? The council started to refine this idea in this great historical context, which we'll get to in a few minutes. The council taught that all the baptized participate in their own proper way, in the three offices of Christ as, look at the words, priest, prophet, and king. The new baptismal rites, when you baptize an adult or a child, baptized, priest, prophet, and king, anointed with the oil of chrism, okay? So the council picks up this whole prophetic tradition as well. Prophets in Old Testament, the prophetic tradition of the saints. And it says this belongs to the faithful, to the baptized. The council, using the biblical image of the whole church as the people of God, reminded the faithful of the universal call to holiness by virtue of baptism and of the responsibility of the church in every age of, quote, reading the signs of the times and interpreting them in the light of the gospel. Just a couple of quotes here. Lumen Gentium 12 states, the holy people of God shares also in Christ's prophetic office. Through the entire people's supernatural sense of the faith, it manifests a universal consensus in matters of faith and morals. De Verbum 8 states, quote, the tradition that comes from the apostles makes progress in the church with the help of the Holy Spirit. There is a growth in insight into the realities being passed on. It comes from the intimate sense of spiritual realities which they, the faithful, experience. So the council, after a very long time, and Kevin's a great expert on experience as a place of theological learning, now the council said there's something about religious experience of the faithful as it's lived out in the Catholic faith. Not just the inspiration of popes and cardinals and bishops and saints, but there's something about the lived experience in terms of, because of the incarnation, of God touching this lived human experience, of God touching the sacramental experience of the church, the liturgical life of the church, that gives this charism and grace to lay people, okay? I'm just going to go on in a couple of minutes to talk a bit more about this whole gift and charism of baptism. You see that photo? That's a very common photo of the Second Vatican Council, okay? You see it everywhere, publications, books, websites, photographs, documentaries, okay? What's always interesting, I always like to talk to you about interesting things. What's interesting, you know, there's the bank of bishops on both sides, okay? They're all the 2,500 bishops from around the world, heads of clerical religious orders, etc., etc., okay? Now, you see, I'm sure it's not any bigger, but you see above the bishops, you've got these little seating areas. See above them? Yeah. They're called the tribunes, okay? When John the 23rd called the Second Vatican Council, because of its ecumenical thrust, he said, well, look, I really want to work towards ecumenism. I want to invite, as observers, the heads of Christian denominations around the world, okay? So the various branches of Orthodoxy, the Anglican Communion, Presbyterians, Methodists, Evangelicals, Churches of Christ, they're all invited, okay? They came, the first session happened, John the 23rd sadly died, Paul the 6th gets elected for the second, third, and then fourth session. At the second and third session, a particularly significant international figure, Cardinal Sunan, said, well, look, here we are talking about the church, Lumen Gentium. We're going to talk about the church and the world, Gaudium et Spes, but a lot of the world isn't here. It's great to have the heads of the other churches because of ecumenism. What about getting the lay faithful here? Right, so Paul VI pulled out his list. He said, let's get a list of distinguished intellectual lay men. Sunan said, terrific, I'll help you put this together. But let's also get some lay women. Right? Because he said, if we're talking to the world, he said, half the world's not here. So Paul VI dutifully wrote down, and we invited a whole swag of lay men and lay women. And they sat there in the tribunes, okay, above the bishops. They weren't voting, but they participated in terms of discussions, meetings, getting all the documentation. So they were really actors behind the scenes. One of the people sitting there was our own Australian, Rosemary Goldie. Has someone heard of Rosemary Goldie? She's a Sydney-born woman, okay? Extraordinary woman. Well before the council started, she was on the international scene with lay apostolate, Catholic action, the Grail, Pax Romana, international body of university students. She was really up there, and she was one of these participants, okay? So our own Australian, Rosemary Gordon, was part of this growing awareness at the council. It's great to have the bishops. It's great to have, you know, the heads of the religious, of the other denominations. We invite lay men, but now we invite lay women as well. And not only was Rosemary there and made an enormous contribution, you can read about this in her book From a Roman Window, the title of her book, but then afterwards, in the wake of the council, when Pope Paul VI established the Pontifical Council for the Laity, a specific department in the Vatican for the laity, he made Rosemary Goldie an undersecretary. Quite rare. As always, bishops or monsignors had these positions, okay? But for the first time, naturally, we're going to have a congregation for lay people. He made her number three of a congregation, completely unheard of in Catholic history. So our own Australian, Rosemary Goldie, made an enormous contribution. Sitting in the tribune, there's also another character there called an American nun. Let me say a very feisty American nun called Sister Mary Luke Tobin. There was a documentary done many years ago, and you know, she was very proud of, you know, battering down the doors of the council and getting in amongst all these bishops and letting the voice of women and religious women in the church be heard. So she tells a story that she was, you know, given access, and she went to some, you know, second-rate Vatican Monsignor who, you know, very authoritatively gave her her pass and said, This pass entitles you to only attend those sessions of direct relevance to your apostolate. And Mary Luke said, great, I'll go to all of them. She's on a documentary that was done back in the 80s. It's actually an old video that I had put on DVD called Vatican II, The Faithful Revolution. It's fabulous listening to her and all the other talking voices from the 80s. So they're all there. So there's this growing awareness of gift, charism, presence of lay people, not just as spectators, not just as passive people in the church, but there was this growing awareness right throughout the council, before, during, and of course after. All right, last dot point on that page. One of the council's greatest gifts to the church was the recovery of the sacramental character of baptism, which is a sharing in the paschal mystery of Christ. Also the recovery of this ecclesiological dimension that makes us members of the body of Christ with our proper dignity. Go through all the documents of Vatican II. Remember, it talks about the laity, baptism. It always says their proper place and dignity in the life of the church. That's a very strong word that the council uses. Dignity. Very key. Proper place and dignity. The council, through this recovery of the great gift and grace of baptism, also picks up the vocational dimension of baptism, whereby we receive our first calling through reception of the gift of faith. Okay? Now again, before the council, when you heard the word vocation, what used to come into people's minds?
Religious.
Yeah, priest and religious, okay? And for a lot of people, it still is the case. The council changed that. The council said, baptism is our first vocation. Baptism is our calling in faith, from which come vocations for the priest and the religious life and the married state. But it really reconfigured the whole idea of the church and what we call the sacramental economy to really focus on baptism and associated that word which we associated with priest and religious to now say, no, we all receive the call of faith in baptism. Little aside, my great pin-up boy, Pope John the 23rd, for those of you who haven't sat at my feet during the course on Vatican II for 12 weeks, some of you may remember in the biographies that are published about him, when he was elected Pope, the Cardinal Deacon asks, and so by what name do you wish to be called? He said, I wish to be called John. It was my father's name, and it's the name of the parish, the humble parish of my baptism. So here he is climbing the absolute pinnacle of ecclesiastical power in the church, and this man says, I choose the name John because it's my father's name. When was the last time the Pope spoke intimately about his father? And the humble parish of my baptism, which I visited four times now and celebrated Mass in the church where he was baptized. So for this man, this is before he even calls the council, Christian baptism is important. In fact, I say to people as the years go on, I remember my ordination 21 years ago at St. Pat's Cathedral on the 23rd of August 1997, great occasion, spectacular, fabulous, wonderful. But as I get older, it must be the Italian nostalgia that kicks in. As I get older, I think more and more about the day of my baptism. November 1969, at Our Lady Help of Christians down the road in Nicholson Street, East Brunswick. I think more and more about my baptism. I think of my parents, Angela and Dominic, my godparents who are still alive, and in very broken English, I presume, that day, saying the church's baptismal promises on my behalf. So as I get older, I love my ordination day, but I think more and more about the day of my baptism, like Pope John. Something happens in baptism. Something changes in our lives forever, and something changes in the church as well. Okay, so the council recover this sense of a vocational spirituality that doesn't just belong to priests and religious. And also what we call the eschatological or cosmological dimension, whereby the church and all of creation are destined for ultimate glory in the fullness of the kingdom of God. And we celebrate this at Easter. You know, Easter Vigil is that wonderful cosmological, eschatological thing of saying baptism is a new creation. And it's a foretaste of the great celebration of the one and only eternal paschal feast one day in heaven. So prior to the council, at times the church, as we know, had a preoccupation, we might say a very narrow view of baptism as the literal, inverted commas, washing away of original sin, and the fear amongst many Catholics that without baptism, one who died lived eternally in limbo. So that was a particularly narrow focus before the council, which we understood why the church taught that. But after the council, we completely reimagined baptism. There's a whole world that the council gave us, a new language around baptism. And again, for those who do my course, they realise it looked like the council invented new doctrines or revolutionised the church. But those who study church history closely realise it was the recovery of an old tradition. Going back to the patristics in the early church, but they had a very strong sense of this grace of baptism, the liturgical sense of baptism, the baptism that forms us as the body of Christ, and the dignity and grace of lay people. All right. Okay. Any questions? Because I can just keep talking about it. That's not the problem. So to my students, questions, comments, or clarifications? Okay. So we're moving on this journey of recognition of baptism and the place and dignity of lay people in the life of the church. Turn over the page. So the living out of this enhanced understanding of Christian baptism and the rightful place of the lay vocation in the life of the church can be seen in the flourishing, after the council, of many liturgical ministries that new people are now involved in lay leadership, which new people are involved in, and in the willing and enthusiastic embracing of theological studies and institutions around the country, such as Catholic Theological College, across the road where I teach, okay? And again, I don't know if it's age, nostalgia, whatever, but as the years go on, I think about what Archbishop Knox did in the early 70s. Informing a new college like CTC. Okay, this is what happened, just to give you a little quick trip through history. All the seminaries trained their own priests, Corpus Christi College at Werribee, Glen Waverley, religious orders had their own seminaries, etc. In the wake of the council, and Knox went to each session of the council, he said, the first thing we're going to do is not isolate the study of theology. So we're going to bring it into a cooperative venture. So he brought the Catholic Church into what was then known as the Melbourne College of Divinity, which has now become the University of Divinity. So the first thing he did in the wake of the council was to say, Catholic theology doesn't get studied out there. It's now brought into a wider institution that's actually ecumenical. That future priests will now have a recognised degree in theology from the state of Victoria, because it comes via an act of parliament, but from a consortium that's actually ecumenical, the Melbourne College of Divinity. That's the first thing that I think was quite radical to do. Bring us into cooperation, no longer isolated theology, but now in an ecumenical venture, okay? The next thing that happened was, in the wake of the council said that the study of theology, the sacred sciences, isn't secret men's business, okay? Lay people and lay women have the right, and in fact the duty, to study theology, okay? So all of a sudden, lay men and women started to pour into the old CTC and Clayton. What's radical about that? Well, men and clerics aren't studying theology on their own. They're now part of an ecumenical institution, but now they've got lay people sitting in the classroom with them and learning theology. And as time passed, these lay people were now equal with the clerics in terms of learning the science of theology. And if they did it hard enough and were faithful to endless hours and doing units of work, they then acquired their Bachelor of Theology, like the priests and seminarians. So they're becoming their theological equal. So when these young men were going into parishes, both religious orders and diocesan priests, they were now preaching to lay people who'd been studying theology. Now, I consider, looking back, I just think that's a quite significant change for the church. Number one. So they're their theological equal now in terms of gaining the same degree in theology. In the last 20 or 30 years, we've now found that there are more and more lay people, and Kevin's our postgraduate coordinator, more and more lay women, who are now getting a master's or a PhD in theology. So when the seminarians get ordained and they go out to parish and start preaching, no longer are they preaching to their theological equal, they're now preaching to their theological superiors. If they've just got their VTOL, they're now looking at a congregation where 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, sometimes 7 have got either a master's or a PhD. That's increasing as time goes on, not diminishing. So I think to myself, what a great gift this has been for the church in terms of a growing awareness of the place of lay people, the charism of baptism, the ability to study theology, the practical implementation of this, the ability to live and feel and study and reflect on and shape the tradition in some way. Before I get on dicey territory, we've got to go to the next dot point. It'll save me from being accused of heresy. Okay? I'd like to introduce you to a friend of mine, Cardinal John Henry Newman. Blessed John Henry Newman. In 1859, Newman wrote a document called On Consulting the Faithful in Matters of Doctrine. Look at the year. On Consulting the Faithful in the Matters of Doctrine. By this time, he'd left the Anglican communion and become a Catholic, okay? So Newman spoke back then of the faithful having their own active role to play in conserving and transmitting the faith. Now, he's using language that's often associated with the hierarchy or the magisterium, but Newman's saying that this is a grace that belongs to the church, to lay people as well, to conserve and transmit the faith. According to Newman, the tradition of the apostles is committed to the whole church, but the bishops and lay faithful bear witness to it in various ways. According to Newman, the tradition manifests itself in the teaching office, of course, of the Pope and bishops, theologians and pastors, but also, he said, by the people, in liturgical rites, in customs, in ceremonies, in the spirituality, the liturgical spirituality of the church. He said, this is all part of the lived experience of faith, the transmission, the conservation, the transmission of the apostolic tradition. But the word consulting is actually key here. So this idea is closely linked to Newman's earlier work, 1845, an essay on the development of Christian doctrine. And theologians such as Yves Congar, writing before Vatican II, adopted Newman's idea of this sensus fidei as an expression of the church's prophetic office, okay? So going back well before the council to this character, who wrote these two very key documents, and anyone who reads anything about Newman, most people writing about Newman say Vatican II was Newman's council. Because so much of the agenda at Vatican II were ideas that Newman was promoting. Ecumenism, the better study of the Bible, the distinctive place of lay people in the church, okay, the development of doctrine. These are all issues that people say Newman was working on in the 20th century and then came to light at Vatican II in the 19th century, came to light with Vatican II in the 20th century. And of course, as Newman's writing this, people are considering him highly suspect. Like, a lot of people, whether they're Anglicans or Catholics, didn't like this sort of stuff. Okay? The church, therefore, speaks of this instinct of faith in terms of reception. It's another key, it's a very dense theological area of study, by which, guided by the Holy Spirit, the people of God recognizes intuitions or insights and integrates them into the patterns and structures of its life and worship. Accepting a new witness to the truth because it perceives them to be in accord with the apostolic tradition. So it's not just a case of the hierarchy of theologians just feeding the laity and they receive it passively. Newman says in the development of doctrine is a whole shaping and living of the tradition, that it expands and develops in time, that it's greatly shaped by the circumstances of the day. And this process of reception is fundamental to the life and health of the church, and for the sake of genuine communion. So, let me give you some historical examples now. How sensus fidei is lived or has been practiced in the life of the church. Two key dates here, both to do with Marian doctrines, okay? In 1854, 1964, Pope Pius IX gave us the dogmatic declaration of the Immaculate Conception. Okay? In 1950, Pope Pius XII gave us the dogma of the Assumption. This was evidence of the papacy's consultation of the bishops, and both popes would say, of the sensus fidelium. That it's not just about doctrine, it's about this sense of the belief and prayer and spirituality and liturgical observances of the faithful. Okay? This confirms what the Pope teaches dogmatically. Something he consults the bishops for an opinion, and what they reflect is something that the faith, you know, in terms of Marian devotion of the 19th and 20th century, there's something that the faithful grab and live and exalt and communicate and ritualize in the life of the church through piety, devotions like the rosary, Marian celebrations, etc. Okay? So it's not just a consultation of bishops. What do you think? They are reflecting the lived experience, the life of the church as well. Okay? That's a very practical dimension of what I would say sensus fidelium, lived, accepted, and proclaimed. Okay? Now, we have this other dilemma in the church. Areas of what we call non-reception, a very controversial area, some of you know about, and some of you lived through, after the council in 1968 with Humanae Vitae. The Pope spoke after a commission had written a report. He felt he could not accept all the recommendations of the report. And in that wonderful document, it talks about human sexuality, anthropology, family life, etc., etc. There's one section there where he reaffirms the Church's prohibition of artificial contraception. And the whole world seemed to have exploded. There was already explosions in the 60s with the Vietnam War and student uprisings, but that was almost like petrol on the fire. He could have written a document 5 years earlier, he could have written it 10 years later, he wrote it when he wrote it, and that's what happened. Okay? So it's caught up in this whole conflagration of the 60s. We've got this problem here of Marian doctrine is seen as part of the lived experience of the faithful. When the Pope taught in terms of this document, it generally was not received, not accepted. Okay? Now this raises a dilemma for the church in terms of sometimes it's received positively, and sometimes it's reacted to negatively and not received in terms of the faithful, not so much complying, but following this aspect of church teaching. So this raises the issue of the teaching office of the Pope and bishops, and for the faithful to accept this teaching and adhere to it with what the canonists say, theologians say, religious assent. Now, here's the dilemma for us, that the church teaches truth, but not by taking opinion polls on issues of faith and morals. The Pope doesn't say, hands up those who believe this, righto, 58%. Hands up those who believe that, oh, 85%, even better. Hands up those, it's not an opinion poll. So we've got this dilemma in the church of respecting the faithful, especially since the Vatican Council. Newman writes a document called On Consulting the Faithful, which again, in his mind, wasn't an opinion poll, but in terms of the active place of lay people in the shaping of church practice and church teaching. But the word consulting in our Western democratic mind means take a poll. Democracy says if 51% approve it, it should be approved, sort of stuff. And that's not how the teaching office of the church. So it does raise this dilemma for the church, for the hierarchy, and for theologians as well. So there can be no simple identification between the sensus fidei and majority or public opinion. In 68, with Humanae Vitae, majority of public opinion did not accept it. But with other areas of the church's teaching, it was accepted, it was lived, etc. So it does raise this dilemma in terms of how this is lived and practiced in the life of the church. Now, interestingly, the document which I quoted at the beginning of my presentation tonight, Sensus Fidei, long theological document, if you want to read it, check it out with a Google search, it's quite long, but quite interesting really. That document in 2014 quotes the Roman principle, the principle of Roman law, that, quote, what affects everyone should be discussed and approved by all. It's an old Roman principle. What affects everyone should be discussed and approved by. Now that whole is a whole series of issues that we've been spent 5 weeks looking at. But that document quoted that principle. How that's lived and applied in the church is a dilemma for us, is a slight difficulty. But I think we're moving in new directions here. Okay. Questions, clarifications? Not a bit of a journey here, folks. We're going to come to more journey very soon. So the Second Vatican Council moved in areas very quickly embraced by the lay faithful, such as the renewal of the liturgy, lay leadership, ecumenism and interfaith relations, and of course, as I mentioned, the serious study of theology. The existence in most parishes of, I've said most, not all, the existence of parish councils or parish leadership teams, parish finance committees, while technically advisory, because priests are told all the time by bishops and canon lawyers that technically they are advisory in character and not executive in the strict sense of the word, nonetheless they exist in order to take seriously the church's teaching on the dignity of lay leadership in the church. That they shouldn't be just places where a priest says all the things he's going to do, the faithful look and nod in furious agreement, and everybody goes home, okay? It should be a place where true lay leadership is exercised, collaborative lay leadership is exercised, but they're still advisory in the technical sense, but not executive. According to the 1983 Code of Canon Law, quote, Christ's faithful are at liberty to make known their needs. Are at liberty to make known their needs. Watch this next line. But they have the right, indeed at times the duty, to manifest to their sacred pastors their views on matters which concern the good of the church. Interesting development of language there. At liberty to make known your needs, but sometimes they have the right and the duty. Now, canon lawyers don't put those words in by accident. They're going to use words like right and duty. They're strong words, so you hope that they believe them and it's given practical effect in the life of the church. Okay? In 2009, before we talk about the prison papers, let's go back to the old one, because I like studying history. In 2009, at the Pastoral Convention of the Diocese of Rome, Pope Benedict XVI spoke of the need for a change in mindset, he said, particularly concerning lay people. And he made a statement which caused a lot of flutter at the time, and it sort of got left there, but it was quite interesting in terms of what he said and how he said it. He said, quote, they, the lay faithful, must no longer be viewed as collaborators of the clergy, but truly recognised as co-responsible for the church's being in action, thereby fostering a consolidation of a mature and committed laity. We use the word collaborators. What do we generally mean by that? Collaborators.
Together.
Working together?
Active participants.
Active participants?
On equal terms.
Sorry?
On equal terms.
Equal terms?
Shared mission.
Okay. That's collaboration. We generally, well, I'm not a wordsmith, I don't watch letters and numbers, you know, but with a big dictionary there, Oxford or Macquarie, whatever it is, but collaborators, working together, okay? Or we use the word co-responsible. That sort of shifts the gear. To collaborate? I mean, even a dictator can have collaborators, technically. But then he shifted it when he said co-responsible. And it caused a lot of flutter, but it didn't go anywhere. Because he didn't give us a systematic treatment of what he was saying. But people picked up on these two words because, and I'll come to this point in a few minutes, in the wake of the council, when it reimagined the role of the Pope and bishops working together, the word collegiality became a buzzword of Vatican II. Collegiality in terms of the church working together, but also the Pope isn't some sovereign monarch. That with the bishops of the world, the theologians say, that the Pope governs the church not as a monarch, but in collegiality with the bishops of the world, so that they are co-responsible with him. That's what collegiality means. It doesn't mean we're just jigsaws on a big board, and the Pope is a sovereign monarch, but to use the word collegiality means that all the bishops are co-responsible with Peter and under Peter. So, Dennis Hart's the Archbishop of Melbourne, but by virtue of his ordination as bishop, he is in communion with the See of Peter, the Pope. And with the Pope, he has a pastoral concern for the whole church. He can't interfere with the whole church, his jurisdiction is only Melbourne. But all bishops are meant to have this sense of collegially working with the Pope. So that's where the word, I think, co-responsible actually touches on that area of collegiality, which only affects bishops and the Pope. But to use the word collaborator is one thing. To move it into the realm of co-responsible in terms of laity, I think is actually touching on that idea from the Council about collegiality. As in having an organic concern. Dennis Hart can't interfere with, you know, the Diocese of Madagascar or somewhere in Austria or whatever. But by virtue of his ordination as a bishop and in communion with the Pope, he's meant to have a pastoral, all bishops are meant to have a pastoral concern for the whole unit, for the universal church. And that is a co-responsibility they share with the successor of Peter. So Pope Benedict, and of course the flutter around, everyone's giving a commentary on this, what did he mean, what does it involve, but he didn't develop early at all. But it was a convention of the Diocese of Rome, he's the Bishop of Rome, of course, just awakening us to the use of these words, collaborator and co-responsible. So I make the point that he used it to raise awareness of his for his audience in Rome, however, he did not give a fully elaborated or systematic treatment of the concept. That's funny, because that's how Ratzinger thinks. He's a theologian, professor. He thinks in terms of systematic theology. So he raised the issue, he gave us the words, but didn't give us a more elaborated, practical living out of this. But I think this is all part of a growing awareness in the church that's been coming really from Newman, but also since the Second Vatican Council. Of course, Vatican II reminded the church that the laity have their proper place and function, and not simply to be activated when there is a shortage of priestly or religious vocations. Now, I love the council. While there's breath in my lungs, I'll always speak positively about Vatican II. One of those urban myths or popular stereotypes that emerged in the wake of the council, you see it written and people say it, because of the shortage of priests after Vatican II, the laity had to move into action. The laity had to take up leadership. That's not quite true. All the documents of the council speak about this proper place of the lay vocation, regardless of how many priests there are in the world. So we think that the laity moved into action only when there was a shortage of priests. And in fact, Archbishop Mannix here in Melbourne, at 99 years of age before he died, he criticised one of these original documents saying, you give no place to the laity other than when they're moved by the hierarchy. He said that at 99. He said, this document, which the document which became Lumen Gentium, he said, the only place it's given to the laity is when they are pushed by the clergy. He's saying, I think you better change that in terms of the spirit of the council. You see? Now, if he could say that at 99, what should we be saying and doing? Okay? So that corrects one, I shouldn't say a fault, but one of the popular mythologies that priests and religious declined in number and then the laity had to rise up. Well, that's sort of what happened practically, but that's not what the council envisaged. Lumen Gentium, Gaudium et Spes, the actual document on the laity, we've had 21 ecumenical councils. Vatican II was the first council that ever spoke about the laity. We have a whole document. Then we set up a whole Vatican commission for them. It put all that in place regardless of how many priests there are, and religious there are. Proper place of laity. In fact, I often use the example for people. Remember, 10, 11 years ago, we had serious water restrictions in Melbourne. Right. Remember what happened? As the water levels in the dams went down, we activated stage one water restrictions. As the water went down even further, we activated stage two. As the water went down, we activated stage three. The council didn't work like that. We didn't start activating lay people as the number of priests and religious went down. The council spoke with a particular vision about this census fidei, the place of the dignity of baptism, but also the place of lay people in the life of the church. So we need to correct these ideas that, as Archbishop Mannix spoke against, that laity only ought to move when they're given a push by the clergy. They have their proper place and dignity by virtue of baptism. The Second Vatican Council recovered a dynamic sense of collegiality in the church, as we've already talked about, that the Pope as universal pastor governs the church in collaboration with each local bishop. And this idea was institutionalised in the Synod of Bishops, which is held every 3 years. Now, this is interesting. However, since his election in 2013, Pope Francis seems to be emphasising this idea of synodality. The whole church, as the people of God, journeying together, as he said, on the night of his election. Now, I grant this insight not to my great genius, but to a friend and colleague from overseas, Massimo Fagioli, Italian-born theologian now working in Rome, historian, who's come to Australia and spoken at various places and forums. He said, collegiality became the buzzword after Vatican II, and lay people love to use it, but it belongs to bishops and the Pope. Collegiality is about the Pope and the bishops together have a pastoral concern for the universal church. Massimo Fagioli said, it's been one of those buzzwords about Vatican II, but it only concerns the Pope and the bishops, really. He said, since Pope Francis' election, he's pushing this whole idea of synodality, a much more Eastern idea from the Eastern tradition of the church. The whole church moving and journeying together. I find that quite interesting. Even more so from the Pope. See, Pope Francis, the first Pope, has never attended Vatican II. All the popes before him attended the Vatican Council in one shape or form. John the 23rd, my pin-up boy, called the council. Paul VI attended the first session and then, of course, was the Pope for the three sessions. Remember his successor in 78, the Pope of only 33 days? John Paul I, he went to all the sessions as well. In fact, why did he call himself John Paul I? The first and ever double-barreled name for a pope. He said, John XXIII named me a bishop and consecrated me personally in St. Peter's Basilica. Paul VI made me Patriarch of Venice and appointed me a cardinal. I have nothing of the holiness and sanctity of Pope John. I have nothing of the culture and learning of Pope Paul. But to honour both these men, I hereby call myself John Paul I. Again, he went to each session of the council, okay? 33 days. 78, John Paul II arrives, Polish Pope. He'd been to all the sessions of the council as well. His successor, Joseph Ratzinger, he wasn't a bishop at Vatican II, but a theological advisor, what they call a peritus, right in the heart of it with Cardinal Frings of Germany, drafting documents, redrafting, giving advice in that very subtle, clear, systematic German way. Along comes Pope Francis, never went to Vatican II, ever. Not as a priest, not as a bishop, not as a theologian. He's the first post-conciliar pope. So I find it interesting that the post-conciliar pope has now moved us from collegiality, which is about the pope and the bishops working together to govern the church or have pastoral concern for the church, pope and bishops, to now push this idea of synodality, the whole church working together. Look at what he wrote in that document, Evangelii Gaudium, number 33. Pope Francis states, pastoral ministry seeks to abandon the complacent attitude that says, quote, we have always done it this way. I invite everyone to be bold and creative in this task of rethinking the goals, structures, style and methods of evangelization in their respective communities. The important thing is not to walk alone, but to rely on each other as brothers and sisters in a wide and realistic pastoral discernment. Not to walk alone. Synodals, moving, working, discerning together. Okay? And also note, I think is important, the Pope's emphasis on what he calls the theology of the peripheries. He's just appointed another batch of cardinals. You can look it up in terms of where they're from. They're from the most obscure parts of the world. Who didn't become a cardinal? The traditional places. Sydney didn't become a cardinal. Venice is still waiting. Florence is still waiting. Turin, who used to get a red hat, is still waiting. And they could be waiting a long time. Because he's made it clear that although they are bigger sees, they are traditional sees where you get the red hat, he said, I'll make the Bishop of Tonga a cardinal. I'll make the Bishop of Madagascar a cardinal. I'll make the Bishop... The theology of the local church, although it's smaller and further away from continental Catholic Europe, he's saying this church matters. This church I'm lifting up. And he's not doing this. Lumen Gentium did that in the document of Vatican II. He didn't say the most important churches are the metropolitan ones, and then he got these scattered places around the world. He said all dioceses are manifestations of the local church gathered around the local bishop as pastor. So Francis has his whole theology of the peripheries in terms of what he's doing with the appointment of cardinals, in terms of not giving it to places where they have had it in the past and weren't expecting it, but he's saying something about the periphery, both a physical periphery, but also another periphery for him. That at the furthest end is where the action happens. And he's saying at the furthest end, I will lift up your status in the church. I will give you a dignity you've never had before. But I find that quite interesting, this whole thing of a theology of the peripheries, right far away. And as we know in his own pastoral practice in Argentina, in Buenos Aires, when he was auxiliary bishop, when he became the archbishop, then when he became a cardinal, he never went to the fancy cocktail parties. He was always out on weekends, going to some parish far away. You get on the metro, miles out, what we'd call dinner, go out to Broadmeadows or, you know, Dandenong or Frankston, wherever, miles out, and spend the weekend there. Same as, hear confessions, visit the sick. They often go not to the, you know, salubrious parishes. What did he find when he went there? He went to places where there was crime, poverty, drugs, prostitution, the whole gamut of human experience. For them, The fields of the privilege is important, out miles away from the centre of power in our Catholic mentality, okay? So he's shifting the church, I believe, from one idea of collegiate, this whole thing of synodos, the whole church moving together, but also this whole idea of the peripheries, where he believes the action is not in zone one, but in zone three. And that comes from his own experience as a pastor. Face to face, he went to these places all the time, okay? So, by coincidence, it's no accident that the Australian Catholic Bishops' Conference has announced the 2020 Plenary Council for the Church in Australia, which has been announced and officially launched today. What better Sunday to do it than Pentecost Sunday, okay? Our last Plenary Council, National Plenary, was in 1937, which traditionally was a clerical affair. The bishops, priests, theologians, and canon lawyers, which then issued various decrees and universal legislation, which then had binding force in the church in Australia, okay? By coincidence, although plenaries in Australia were generally clerical affairs, funny enough, at the last one, in 1937, something significant happened. A national body called ANSCA came into being, the Australian National Secretariat of Catholic Action, which prompted lay leadership and the formation in sub-bodies, which have made a significant contribution to the church in Australia. Things like the Young Christian Workers, YCW, the Young Christian Students, YCS, the National Catholic Girls Movement, NCGM. Anyone here belong to the MCGM? NCGM? These young girls? Yeah. I was at a parish once where the pastor was saying, she said, yeah, I belong to the NCGM. We used to call it No Chance of Getting Married. And of course, the National Catholic Choral Movement. Well, this is quite someone else, okay? So, although it was a clerical affair, and it was the last one we had, it actually had this idea of a national body based here in Melbourne that promoted this whole idea of lay formation, lay leadership in terms of Catholic action. But then, of course, we had a couple of splits. There was a split between Melbourne and Sydney, between what we'd say the more clerical view of Sydney, that lay apostolates, lay action had to be governed by priests, and the more, I'd say, more liberal view of Mannix, which said, no, lay leaders are lay leaders. You might have a chaplain, that's fine, but they are the lay leaders. So there was a split between Melbourne and Sydney, and then years later there was a split with the late Bob Santa Maria in terms of Catholic Action, YCW, and a more direct involvement in politics. But that's the historical record. Now, I love that photo, okay? That's a photo of the last plenary, 1937, all right? From the far right, chuckling with great delight is Archbishop James Dewing of Brisbane. Okay? Next to him is the apostolic delegate, the papal representative at the time, Archbishop Giovanni Panico. He took it upon himself, he thought it was his mandate, to Australianise the Australian hierarchy. So he wanted to get rid of as many, not get rid of, but succeed Irish bishops with more Australian-born bishops. Okay? So he and Mannix fought like cats and dogs. Okay. The clergy used to call Archbishop Panico, Giovanni Panico, Panicky Jack. That was a nickname he gave, and he and Mannix really, it was pretty ugly, really. Archbishop Panico in, legend has it, this is amongst the clergy, of course, legend has it that at a gathering he said, I look forward to the day when every bishop in Australia will be Australian. Quick as a flash, Mannix got up and said, I look forward to the day in the future when every apostolic delegate will be Australian. Whack. This is all happening behind the scenes, you see. Next to Panico is Archbishop Michael Kelly of Sydney. Funny seeing Kelly and Mannix together. Kelly was a very pious man. Wouldn't say he was gifted with great intellectual gifts. Very pious, very devout. Of course, Daniel Mannix is next to him, and next to Daniel Mannix is Archbishop Prendeville from Perth. And behind them, you see a bunch of clerical characters. Priests in collars, priests in berettas, and there's a chap there with a pork pie hat. He must be a photographer or something. But the point I'm making is 1937, it was the last national plenary, it was generally a clerical affair. It was a thing that only bishops and theologians and canon lawyers did, okay? That was the last one we had. Now we're moving to a whole new dimension of this 2020 plenary for Australia. So my last off point. Discussion. Since Second Vatican Council, a small number of dioceses in Australia have undertaken a formal diocesan synod, and many have had what we call diocesan assemblies. Right? So a bishop can can have a diocesan assembly every year if he wants. To call a synod, whether it's a diocesan synod or a provincial council or a national council, the bishops have to petition the Holy See and issue and say what it's going to talk about. Once it has its gathering, whatever they agree on or legislate has to be endorsed by the Holy See. So a synod, a local diocesan synod, a plenary provincial council of a group of bishops around, say, a metropolitan city, or a national plenary, it's different from an assembly. Any bishop could call an assembly any time he wants. You can have one once every 6 months if he wants. But a synod is something that's been very different. This is what I find to be an interesting statistic. There have been 138 diocesan synods or provincial councils in Australia between 1844 and 2011. That's a big number of generally clerical affairs. You see my point? There have always been generally clerical affairs. But since Vatican II, last time I checked, that's over 50 years ago, since Vatican II, we've only had 6 diocesan synods in Australia. 2 in Canberra and Goulburn, 1 in Brisbane, 1 in Broken Bay, 1 in Cairns, 1 in Maitland, Newcastle. So when they were clerical affairs, we had lots of them because the church in Australia was developing, it was growing. We had mission stations that then became parishes. Schools had to be established. The whole diocesan structure had to be established. Okay, but since the council, which gave us this sense of the church as the people of God, synodality, collegiality, we've only had 6 of them in 50 years, which I find just an interesting statistic. Go home and think about that. So this proposed 2020 plenary council is a more formal structure and reality. Ideally, more than just a national talk fest, and I believe even wider than the national consultations undertaken by the Australian bishops in the past with things such as the Commonwealth for the Common Good and the participation of women in the Catholic Church in Australia in 1996. So it's more than just a national consultation on one topic. We've had Commonwealth for Common Good, the participation of women. Bishops can have a national consultation on ecumenism and interfaith relations, on theology and spirituality, on ecumenism, on care for the environment. We can have all these things. But a plenary is a different beast and creature. It's meant to do something very different. In first discussing the concept of the plenary, Archbishop Mark Coleridge from Brisbane, who's now the president of the Bishops' Conference, and Archbishop Costello from Perth is now the president of the 2020 plenary, Coleridge has insisted that while it came about largely as a result of the Royal Commission, the real impetus stems from the profound social and cultural changes that the church in Australia is currently facing. He has said, on the record, that it can no longer be business as usual. So national plenary needs to involve the whole Australian church more than just a consultation. It's got to be a new and different plenary, different from the clerical affairs from 1937 and before. So it's still quite new. I don't know anything more than what's on the public record. But I find it interesting that under Pope Francis, in the wake of the Royal Commission, at a time after the council where we had actually fewer diocesan synods, here's this movement for a national plenary, a national gathering of the church, which must make some significant changes, and that lay people will be part of this exercise like never before. Not just as an audience clapping, not just as observers like at the Second Vatican Council, but having a really direct and participatory role. More than just consultations like the 92 and 96. I just find how things have moved from Newman's ideas to the council, in the wake of the council, but even just in these last 5 years under Pope Francis, this quite significant shift in how he imagines the church and his leadership, and this whole idea of, again, the presence and place and dignity and role of lay people. Here we're having a national plenary when we've had so few diocesan synods. This is about a presence and participation of lay people that's, I believe, not going to be passive. There's a whole structure that's been put in place that I know nothing about. All I can say to you is what's on the public record. But just historically, and that's the base of my presentation tonight, it's been historical. When we say census fidei, the sense of the faithful, it fits into this wider historical constellation, I believe. From Newman to Vatican II, in the wake of the council, but at this moment in the church. I believe the theme of the plenary is, what is God saying to the church today? What is the Spirit saying to the church today? And it's not just going to be a clerical affair of bishops, priests, and a jamboree for canon lawyers. That's what they were in the past, but this is moving the church in a different direction. As Coleridge said, it's principally being activated by in the wake of the Royal Commission, but it's about really capturing a new sense of church, a new, renewed sense of church. Now, this is all part of this whole sense of the place of lay people, not as just passive recipients of church teaching, but right from Newman, and then affirmed at Vatican II, actually part of not just the listening church, but the teaching church. Actually part of the development of the tradition, the lived expression of the tradition, the actual shaping of the tradition, and in dialogue with the present culture and situation of the church in the world today.